The Committee on Science, Space, and Technology will reconvene. Welcome to today's hearing entitled Department of Energy Science and Technology Priorities. I'll recognize myself for an opening statement and then the ranking member. To many, the Department of Energy is typically not regarded as a science agency, but from its origins with the Manhattan Project to its current programs and mission, science has always served as DOE's foundation. Approximately $8.5 billion, or one-third of the department's budget, is focused on civilian science and technology activities that fall under this committee's jurisdiction. Accordingly, I want to thank our witness, Dr. Ernie Moniz, for joining us today. His presence here continues our tradition of hearing from the DOE Secretary on a regular basis. Dr. Moniz has a deep knowledge of energy policy, particularly regarding the scientific and technical issues that are the focus of this committee. Dr. Moniz's tenure begins at an extraordinary time in our nation's energy history. We are now just a few years into an energy revolution driven by hydraulic fracturing that has enabled dramatic increases in oil and natural gas production. The notion of true American energy independence, long dismissed as unrealistic, is now attainable, perhaps even by the end of this decade. These developments will greatly benefit not only our economy, but also geopolitics and our national security. The shale boom has been accompanied by important energy policy debates. These include whether the federal government should regulate fracking, whether the Keystone XL pipeline should be built, and how best to handle liquefied natural gas exports. These issues are all of critical importance and all connect to the scientific and technical jurisdiction of this committee. Also of major importance is how we prioritize federal efforts to advance development of alternative forms of energy. In an era of budget constraints, we need to set priorities. I believe that the best approach is to place a higher priority on fundamental research that will enable new energy technologies to become more cost-effective. This makes sense not only from a fiscal perspective, but also from a global perspective. It is widely agreed that any effective solution to climate concerns must be global in nature. And while the U.S. has reduced carbon emissions in recent years, developing countries have shown little desire for voluntarily switching to more expensive forms of alternative energy. For example, China and India are expected to build a combined 200 coal plants in the next 3 years. Global coal use is expected to increase 50% by 2035. Which will dramatically increase carbon dioxide emissions. This won't change unless alternative forms of energy become more cost-effective. So we should shift from costly subsidies to research and market-driven technological solutions that will be used around the world. To me, this is the only practical long-term solution. That concludes my opening statement, and the ranking member, Ms. Johnson, is recognized for hers.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. For holding the hearing today, and I'd like to welcome Secretary Moniz and express my appreciation for his willingness to serve the nation again as he has several times before. Secretary Moniz, you are obviously extraordinarily well qualified, and I believe that you are the right person to lead the Department of Energy at this critical time. Let me start by saying that overall I'm pleased with the Department's budget request this year. If approved, the Office of Science, ARPA-E, and the Office of Electricity, and the Office of Energy Efficiency and Renewable Energy would all receive a much-needed boost to advance the development of clean energy technologies that will be vital to our national security, our economy, and our environment in the decades to come. It is worth reminding my colleagues here today that we have seen how government research can pay off when it comes to energy development. DOE-supported research was key to the development of high-efficiency gas turbines for coal plants, nuclear reactors developed at the federal labs, and the directional drilling and hydraulic fracturing practices that have led to the shale gas boom of today. But we should remember that those achievements required decades of federal investment, the overwhelming majority of which was focused on fossil and nuclear energy. I continue to support research to make today's technologies cleaner and more efficient, but I believe that it is time to level the playing field and introduce real competition to the markets. That is where the priorities set by this budget request come in today and come into play. We have to find the greatest value for our investment of the taxpayers' dollar. And today it is the emerging energy technologies, sectors that will most benefit from our government support. I think it is also important to note that DOE's Office of Science is actually the largest supporter of basic research in the physical sciences in the country. And it operates more than 30 national scientific user facilities whose applications go well beyond energy innovation. Our nation's top researchers from industry, academia, and other federal agencies use these facilities to examine everything from new materials that will better meet our military needs, to new pharmaceuticals that will better treat disease, to even examining the fundamental building blocks of the universe. I believe this is stewardship of unique scientific research, including the nation's major national user facilities, is another important role that I hope the department will continue to make one of its highest priorities. It is no secret that Congress's inability to date to come to an agreement on sensible budget plan has led to some devastating cuts to many of these important programs with serious impacts on our nation's future. I think this budget request is a step in the right direction, and I look forward to working with you, Mr. Secretary, and my colleagues across the aisle to provide you with the direction, the tools, the resources that you need to get us back on track. With that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson. Our only witness today is the Honorable Ernest Moniz, Secretary of the Department of Energy. Prior to his appointment, Dr. Moniz was a professor of physics and engineering systems at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, where he was a faculty member since 1973. Previously, Dr. Moniz served as Undersecretary of the Department of Energy, where he oversaw the department's science and energy programs. From 1995 to 1997, he served as Associate Director for Science in the Office of Science and Technology Policy in the Executive Office of the President. Dr. Moniz received a Bachelor of Science degree in Physics from Boston College and a Doctorate in Theoretical Physics from Stanford University. He brings both impressive academic credentials and practical skills to a very demanding job. Dr. Moniz, we welcome you today and look forward to your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Johnson, members of the committee. I appreciate the opportunity to appear before you today for my first time and in this incarnation and to lay out my vision for the Department of Energy path forward over the next few years. And I certainly look forward to working with this committee during that time. I'm pleased to be back at the department. As noted, I served as Undersecretary during the Clinton administration, as well as at OSTP. At MIT, I would just add to the chairman's description that I also served as head of the Department of Physics, and perhaps of direct relevance as director of the Bates Linear Accelerator Center, which was, at that time, a Department of Energy user facility. So I've seen the department from that end as well. More recently, I was the founding director of the MIT Energy Initiative. So today, again, I'll lay out a bit of my vision for how the department can meet some of the pressing challenges before us and touch on some of the initiatives in the President's fiscal year 2014 budget request for the department. Clearly, I'll start by discussing the science programs, and I want to thank again both the chairman and the ranking member for pointing out the critical role that Department of Energy plays in the science enterprise of this country, and also how science and technology really is the thread that runs through all the diverse missions of the department. The science programs are crucial to fostering scientific and technological breakthroughs, especially in the physical sciences. Department provides the national science community with unique research opportunities at major facilities for nuclear and particle physics, for energy science, for materials research and discovery, for large-scale computation, and other disciplines. And the President is committed to making investments in R&D that will grow the economy and enable our country to remain competitive. A couple of weeks ago, I made my first trip as Secretary to Oak Ridge National Laboratory, where I saw Titan, then the world's fastest supercomputer. I was told today that yesterday China has now fielded a machine that is now number one. And I might say this area of large-scale computation, modeling and simulation, one in which the Department of Energy has helped this country in its leadership role for many, many decades, is fiercely competitive with China, the EU, Japan, others investing large resources. And in fact, of interest in China, a stated goal of training 1 million students in the use of high-performance computing for various applications. While at Oak Ridge, I also visited the Consortium for Advanced Simulation of Light Water Reactors along this theme of large-scale computation. This is the first of existing energy innovation hubs. I made that slip because MIT is a partner in that hub. In its first 3 years, CASEL has already released software that simulates a virtual operating physical reactor. And the President's budget continues support for this and other hubs and proposes a new one in electricity systems, following the recent awards to Argonne and Ames for batteries and energy-critical materials, respectively. The President's budget also continues support for DOE's Energy Frontier Research Centers, run out of the Basic Energy Sciences Office, and these are working to solve specific scientific problems that are barriers to clean energy technology development. The budget request also supports the continuation of DOE's three bioenergy research centers, which are very successfully pursuing basic research underlying a range of high-risk, high-return biological solutions for energy applications. Within science, nuclear and particle physics continue to shed light on fundamental properties of matter at the subatomic level. In the nuclear program, we have a robust program operating the relativistic heavy ion collider, continuing the major upgrade at Jefferson Lab in Virginia, and initiating a new facility at Michigan State. In particle physics, we clearly have to consider what is going to be our direction, particularly with Fermilab, our flagship facility, right now pursuing the intensity frontier. And this will be an important development over the next 3 years, how we see the vector for high-energy physics. Let me turn, if I may, briefly to energy technology and policy. As the chairman noted, in the last 4 years since President Obama took office, the global energy landscape has undergone a profound change. The United States oil and gas production has increased each year, while oil imports have fallen to a 20-year low. At the same time, renewable electricity generation has doubled and should double again in the next several years, and carbon emissions have simultaneously fallen to the lowest level in the U.S. in nearly two decades. But even with the increase in domestic oil and gas production, high gasoline prices still impact American families and businesses every day and remind us that we are still too reliant on oil. The President has emphasized there's no silver bullet, but we continue to pursue a multi-pronged approach in terms of efficient vehicles, alternative fuels, and vehicle electrification. Another important focus, one that I've emphasized quite strongly as well, is that on energy efficiency. The President's goal is to double American energy productivity by 2030, saving consumers and businesses money and increasing competitiveness. Efficiency really is the fifth fuel. And of course, we will continue our cutting-edge science and technology research, R&D, to accelerate the transition to a low-carbon economy through cost reduction as the principal goal of innovation. Given the time, I will just say a few words about moving forward with programs like ARPA-E, which I consider to be a critical part of, of this country's energy innovation system, and also noting how it suggests that we continue to have an enormous amount of untapped innovation capacity that we should try to bring to bear. Finally, in discussing energy, I will note that I also served on President Obama's Council of Advisors on Science and Technology, PCAST, and PCAST at the end of 2010 recommended a new process called the Quadrennial Energy Review for weaving together the many strands that must go into a coherent energy policy. This will require much stronger analytical capabilities, which will be a focus for me in these years. And I look forward to working with the others in the administration, the Congress, industry, NGOs, and others to advance this new approach to quadrennial energy review. In concluding, I will just say that in addition to these mission areas, and of course we also have the nuclear security and environmental remediation areas, but I want to say that improving the management and performance of the department is one of my top priorities as Secretary. I intend to pursue this in at least four areas: better integrating science and energy programs, elevating the focus on management and performance as an enterprise-wide requirement, increasing the analytical capability, as I said, as an essential underpinning for energy technology and policy, and creating clearer lines of authority and responsibility for security across the department. So in summary, Mr. Chairman, the department has significant responsibilities that bear on America's economic, energy, environmental, and nuclear security future, and I'm fully committed to working with the Congress in search for solutions. I look forward to our discussion.
Okay. Thank you, Secretary Moniz. Let me recognize myself for questions. And my first one goes to the loan guarantee programs. The Government Accounting Office says that there are 8 new loan guarantee programs under consideration at a total cost of about $2 billion. Is that accurate? And if not, what is the right figure as far as the loan guarantee programs that might be announced, say, this year?
Well, I'm not quite sure what that figure refers to specifically, but there is in the 1703 program, which I think is probably being referred to, the one that has a conditional agreement for a loan for the nuclear reactors in Georgia of about $8 billion. So that still remains to be seen where that goes. And there is consideration as authorized for developing a potential program in the fossil fuel area.
Okay, and those are the only loan guarantee programs you're aware of that might be under consideration?
To my knowledge, that's what are being considered. The other area where there is additional authority is in the advanced vehicle program, but currently there is no.
What about alternative forms of energy, wind, solar, and so forth?
Again, I will go back and check, okay. Mr. Chairman, for sure, but what I'm aware of right now that's active is the conditional loan on the nuclear reactors and considerations about a fossil program.
Okay, no imminent announcements on any.
Well, I'd better check that to be sure.
Okay.
That's my knowledge.
Okay. Fair enough. Right. The other question related to that is that will the loan guarantee programs put the interest of taxpayers ahead of the interest of others?
Absolutely. I believe the program is always striven to do
that. So if a company fails, the taxpayers would be paid back first?
Well, yes, sir. I mean the overall judgment will be to protect taxpayer dollars.
Okay. The reason I asked that was, Solyndra, you had the situation that before bankruptcy was actually declared, the loan was restructured and the taxpayers were put second instead of first, but you don't envision that happening again.
We have no such plans for that, but I can guarantee always putting taxpayers' interests first.
Great. Thank you. Let me move on to the subject of climate change and ask you, what percentage of climate change do you think is attributable to human activity and what percentage to other causes?
Well, sir, I wouldn't know how to put a percentage on it, okay. But I believe the science is clear that man-made activity is a major contributor to the global warming that we are seeing.
Right. Assuming that, though, is there any way to estimate what percent? Is it over half, 50%, 75%, 90% is attributable to human activity?
Well, I would say is that in my scientific view, what we are seeing is consistent with being driven by man-made activities. Clearly, there are background variabilities.
You have natural cycles. You have solar influence, and so forth.
Correct. But basically, my statement is based on the fact that if one simply looks at the amount of one has known for over a century how CO2. In particular, drives global warming through the greenhouse effect. We know how much CO2 we emit from combustion, and we know how much CO2 is accumulating in the atmosphere, and we know the time trajectory of those.
But still no way to know what percentage is attributable to human activity.
Well, I don't know how to make a percentage, but okay. Again, I think there's no doubt in my mind that anthropogenic causes are major probably the major driver of climate change.
Thank you. And then last question is this, and this is asking you to speculate and be creative, I guess. And it is for this reason. Suppose we're looking at possible breakthrough technologies that would reduce carbon emissions, and we were looking for breakthroughs that did not involve increasing taxes or subsidies. What are some possible breakthroughs that we might see in the next 5 to 10 years that would allow us to reduce carbon emissions without raising taxes and without subsidies? Do you have any idea on that? I'm thinking about batteries or maybe more efficient buildings, things like that, but any other ideas that you might have?
Well, certainly in the area of efficiency, I think there remains enormous opportunity, and buildings, as you've said, are a major focus area. 70% of electricity goes into our buildings. On the supply side, in about 10 years, we hope to have the first small modular nuclear reactor deployed, which could be the beginning of an interesting new industry for us. Solar energy has come down enormously in cost, and I believe that within 10 years, we will be surprised at its level of deployment. And very critically, batteries, energy storage, which you also mentioned, is critical. Costs have come down very dramatically. There remains a significant way to go to get what I would call mass market vehicle technology there. But it's been tremendous progress. In fact, I just mentioned the Tesla, as for example, has dropped its base cost by nearly a factor of two in about 4 years.
Okay. Thank you, Secretary Moniz. And let me apologize to you. I am on another committee that is having an all-day markup that has already begun, so I'm going to need to excuse myself, though I hope to be back in about an hour. And Dana Rohrabacher, I think, is going to take the chairmanship, and I'll look forward to seeing you later.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mm-hmm.
I finally got it in my hands.
This is frightening.
Well, even with that, you're recognized for your 5 minutes.
Thank you very much. This is a gentleman that I've served on this committee with now in the 21st year, so I do know him pretty well. Secretary Moniz, I understand that your previous job as director of MIT Energy Initiative, you played a major role in examining the impacts of energy development on and on water use and vice versa. So I am sure you already know that this is a significant issue for my state, and I appreciate your responsiveness to my recent letter to you on the subject. But can you briefly describe the department's current activities to address the critical link between energy and water, and are there further actions you plan to take in this area now that you are the boss?
Thank you, Congresswoman. The energy-water nexus is clearly one of greatly increased attention, and rightly so, because this is a very, very challenging problem. In fact, it's often not recognized that approximately half of United States water withdrawals are just for thermal power plants alone. And of course, water issues have become very prominent in hydrocarbon production. So at the department, we have a task force that's been put together on energy and water. They have been developing ideas. There are some collaborations, for example, with EPA and DOI, specifically on the water issues with hydrofracking. The issues of addressing lower water use, particularly as drought comes across much of our country, are critical. I have asked our task force to develop a draft program plan for this fall that would give us an idea what might be a new direction that we could then discuss with members and, of course, in the administration to see how we might shape a program more forcefully aimed at energy and water.
Thank you. As one of the nation's most respected physicists, can you briefly describe how the greenhouse gas emissions trap heat in Earth's atmosphere?
Okay, I could use a blackboard then, but quite briefly, the issue is that incoming sunlight, especially let's say in the visible range, obviously we see the sun, so that sunlight comes through to the Earth, it's absorbed, it is then re-radiated as infrared, and then certain molecules like carbon dioxide trap that infrared radiation, and that creates the greenhouse effect, which then leads to warming. And this has been known, I might say this has been known since the 19th century.
What are the major risks to our nation if we don't reduce our greenhouse gas emissions, and are there any increased risk if we delay the action?
Well, certainly I think the risks of global warming are very, very considerable. Of course, it is an issue in the end of global greenhouse gas emissions. With an increase and continued warming, we are seeing, of course, already indicators such as the dramatic effects on sea ice. But also, I think here in this country, we are seeing statistically the expectations written down 20 years ago playing out, such as droughts, wildfires, storm intensity increases. Again, one can never assign any specific event to the warming, but statistically it seems to be there. So, and the problem is it's happening very, very rapidly compared to historical natural cycles. Also, I should have talked about sea level rise, which then couples with storms to have storm surges, the kind of thing that we saw with Sandy.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
And the chair now recognizes me. First of all, welcome aboard.
Thank you.
And I'm sure we're going to enjoy our kibitzing, as I've enjoyed it with your predecessor as well. Let's, while we're talking about global warming, let me get this straight. You don't know what the natural production of CO2 is compared to the human production? Is that what your answer to the chairman was?
No, sir. I said I know how much CO2 we are producing.
Yeah.
From anthropogenic causes.
But you don't know the percentage of what is in the atmosphere is caused by human beings versus the natural production.
So the amount of CO2 from anthropogenic sources actually significantly exceeds, in fact, the amount that is net remaining in the atmosphere as the oceans reabsorb some of it. So actually, one could argue that, you know, anthropogenic sources really is a very, very major driver.
So the ocean doesn't absorb the CO2 that's produced by man, but it does absorb that's produced by nature, and you don't know how much is produced by nature?
No, I mean a CO2 molecule is a CO2 molecule.
Correct.
And there is a carbon cycle, and in that carbon cycle, there's a net, at least today, there is a net absorption in the oceans and in the land masses.
Okay. I would appreciate if you could, when you go back and check, I mean, it's surprising you don't have the answer on top of your head, exactly what percentage of the CO2 that we're talking about with the greenhouse effect here, what percentage of CO2 in the atmosphere is caused by human activity and what is caused by a natural activity? And,
again, we know the overall fluxes because in the carbon
what is
cycle.
It?
I'd have to go back and really get the numbers straight.
All right.
But go
back and get that.
Okay.
Fine. Now,
right.
Let me ask you this. Now, you're from MIT, and I appreciate I'm from Long Beach State, and you're from MIT. But I have
good just, basketball.
Yeah. All right. There are other people with credentials like Richard Lindzen from MIT, who are very skeptical of some of the research that's been going on and have articulated that. Yet we have, just a few weeks ago, an offshoot of President Obama's reelection campaign listed climate deniers. The only other term of that, you know, use of that term is a Holocaust denier. Do you use the term denier for those people who disagree with you on climate science? And do you think that term is appropriate in engaging in a civil discourse over a scientific issue?
I much prefer a civil discourse, and that's what I hope we are engaging in.
All right. Right. Thank you very much. Now, in terms of, I certainly am very pleased to hear your commitment to small modular nuclear reactors. I'm rather concerned in the development of those small modular reactors that new technology is being focused on rather than light water technology, which is not new technology. Is there some way we're going to meet that challenge that that these new small modular reactors are going to be based on a new concept, which I think is much safer and to the public by going with not going with the old light water reactor system?
Well, of course, the first award that was made, as you know, was for a light water reactor based system, and that's the one that we anticipate being deployed about by 2022 or so, assuming the licensing goes well, et cetera. And of course, light water reactors will have an advantage in terms of NRC familiarity with that technology for, right, for licensing. In the call that's out now, there will be, I'm sure, although I don't actually know this, we're in the middle of it, but it's certainly open to both light water reactor and other technologies.
Yeah. Let me note that I think if we're going to be moving forward to with a new technology, it should not be based on old concepts when if there are new ones available. And I'm looking forward to working with you and seeing that we can try to develop this new type of small modular reactor that's going to serve our purposes decades into the future. And one last note, one last question is that is we are spending billions of dollars in wind-related research, and this is, I mean, across the board here, I think it's $4 billion in 82 different federal wind-related initiatives. For a small fraction of that cost, there are people who are, this committee also oversees NASA, there are people in NASA who suggests that we might be able to develop a space-based solar system that would, again, be clean energy coming from space and on the be able to be unloaded on a ground receiver that's a lot less obtrusive than a refinery, et cetera. Do you have any inclinations toward, or do you know about this concept of space-based solar power and what's your reaction to it?
Well, I'm certainly aware of the concept, which has been around for quite some long time. Yeah. I have not studied it. The last I knew that it was felt by many, at least, to be rather impractical in terms of the resource requirements. But I'd be happy to look at that again if you think it's okay. an area to look.
Yeah, I'll be looking forward to going through that with you. And now, Mr. Lipinski.
Hey, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Secretary Moniz, for being here today. I think your confirmation 97-0 in the Senate is a great testament to you and in your work. We rarely see anything like that up here on Capitol Hill these days, so I think that really shows a great respect for not only the work you do, but how you do it. So the first thing I wanted to bring to your attention is a topic that I raise a lot in this committee, which is the National Science Foundation's Innovation Core program. As you may know, the iCore program is an entrepreneurial education program developed by serial entrepreneurs in the Silicon Valley that teaches scientists how to be entrepreneurial. And as I'm sure you understand that this is something that does not come naturally or has been taught to a lot of scientists. Some of our great researchers out there. Now, the program's already having an impact because we saw 3 months ago a team that went through the iCore program found a company called Neon that secured seed funding from a private venture capital group. And the founders of NEON have credited their current market strategy to the lessons that they learned, the connections they made through the I-Corp program. In April, I wrote to the Department of Energy about this program, and Dr. Holdren has testified before this committee that the administration sees a lot of promise in entrepreneurial education programs like I-Corp. I think researchers funded by the Office of Science and other areas of DOE would benefit from participating in this program as well. So this is more of a comment than a question, but I would urge you to take a look at the I-Corp program, because I think entrepreneurial education for energy researchers could have a tremendous impact on getting new energy technologies to the market more efficiently. And that's, a perfect lead into the
thank you.
What I wanted to address next and ask you about. Argonne National Lab, which is in my district, is the proud home of an energy innovation hub and energy storage and battery technology, as you mentioned in your opening remarks. I supported strongly this application by Argonne, and I'm very proud of the work that they're doing, because I think it has the potential to be transformative both for transportation sector and for renewable energy. Now, at the same time, there's more to Argonne than just a battery hub. Resources like the Advanced Photon Source, the Mira supercomputer, and the Nuclear Energy Program, among others, all have worldwide renown. So I'd like to get your ideas, Dr. Moniz, for how the innovation hubs will work moving forward. And along the same lines, how can DOE ensure that the U.S. maintain the right level of commitment to national laboratories in all their world-leading scientific facilities, as well as the science and energy challenges in close cooperation with the industry? I think this is a great energy hubs, our innovation hubs, are fantastic. We also face the challenge of how do we balance this with all the other great work that's being done at these facilities. So I want to get your views on this.
Thank you. There are several parts to the question. If I may just make a note that your discussion about storage for both vehicles and grids, that actually I sent a letter just this week to Senator Wyden at his request, looking that lays out a schedule for us to develop a plan for grid-scale storage. So that's something you may be interested in as well. I'd be happy to share that with you. With regard to hubs, I personally believe that the hubs are a very important way for the department to do business. The assembly of multidisciplinary teams of scientists and engineers work across the innovation chain as fits the mission purpose, and it's something that I would like to support strongly. Of course, we have to make sure they are also being managed well and heading to their goals, and I intend to carry out a review of the existing five hubs to see how we can strengthen them and strengthen future hubs. I might say that with the national labs, you mentioned the national labs broadly. Frankly, I think this is the way the national labs, in my view, should do more of their business, with significant teams focused for an extended time on an important problem. I think that's what the labs can do really uniquely, much more easily than a typical university environment. And I have had the pleasure of now meeting twice with the lab directors, once by video, once in person, and I think they are on the same page as I am in that last statement. And very importantly, I think I've said that I would like to work with the leadership of the labs in a much more strategic way than I think has been the case for some time now. As my friend George Shultz likes to say, when you want people there on the landing, you should have them there on the takeoff, and I want the lab directors up front talking about our strategic directions.
Thank you very much. I think it's important that we continue on and pursue these innovation hubs, but we can't lose sight of what else is going on at the lab. So I thank you very much. Yeah.
If I may just add a comment, I would say not only the labs but also the universities, where the issue of a lot of smaller groups and single investigators is very, very important. We need to have the right balance.
Thank you. Yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Lipinski. And Mr. Hall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I thank you and the former chairman 15 minutes ago. And Secretary Moniz, I thank you for appearing. You appeared before us last week, I believe, to discuss Department of Energy science and technology priorities. Mr. Secretary, as you're well aware, the process of hydraulic fracturing has revolutionized the energy industry, helping really putting our country, America, on the course for becoming the world's largest producer of oil and gas by the end of the decade. I think those may be partially your words. And you've previously and consistently stated that the environmental impacts from fracking are, quote, manageable, unquote. I think that's too weak, and I want you to improve on that, and I'm going to try to give you a chance to. And that it, quote, certainly was not clear to you that there had been major consequences from fracking. That's positive, too, but it's not quite far enough. Can we go a step further? Let me help you. Last week, you concurred with earlier testimony from former EPA Administrator Lisa Jackson, of all people, that there had not been a single instance in which fracking has been found to contaminate drinking water. That ought to put to rest whether or not fracking has caused drinking water to be bad, shouldn't it? That ought to be enough.
Well, sir, I think, as I said last week as well, I mean, that's...
Well, if you don't think it ought to be enough, tell me and I'll go another paragraph for you.
Well, again, I think I need to clarify my statement. So what I said is the fracturing process, as far as I know of no incidents. But as I also said, it is the conventional activities like well completion, cement jobs, where there have been problems, water management on the surface, methane emissions. All of these are manageable in the sense that we know the solutions. We just have to put the solutions in place all the time.
They're self-manageable because they're thousands of feet apart, aren't they, normally?
Well, no, but the real issue is in the penetration to the ground, the well. It's the first 200 feet as opposed to 7,000 feet below in the fracturing.
Okay. As you know, in the well-publicized instances, the EPA has claimed that fracking caused drinking water contamination in Pavilion, Wyoming, Parker County, Texas, and Pennsylvania, and all these claims turned out to be unfounded and almost dishonest. Several experts have appeared before the committee and confirmed that there had been no evidence or history of hydraulic fracturing affecting usable quality of water. Even Dana, the chairman right here today, asked the last question of an administration member that came here to testify, left the president's desk to come here to testify. And the last question Dana asked him was, do you know of anywhere, any time in the history of the United States of America that fracking has caused drinking water damage? And his answer was no. Are you aware of that?
I wasn't aware of that specific answer, but it's very consistent with what I've said, yes.
And given the EPA's poor track record, how can the federal government repair its reputation on fracking? Now, we'd have worked on that reputation if it had been a different president appointed and elected last year. It wasn't. So we have a president that thinks different to what the president we offered, I think, would have had on fracking. I think we would have looked into some of the testimony that they came here and gave under oath. And will you work with EPA to assure, quote, good objective measurements and analysis that you've stated are needed? You're going to do that, aren't you? We think you are, and we hope you are.
Well, sir, first of all, I have to say that, I mean, the president, in my view, is all of the above energy policy, and he's been very supportive of the developments of the gas industry.
I don't have enough time to go into it with you as to whether or not he's been supportive. I have a very 100% different opinion that you have about the president's support of energy.
Okay, well, that could be a longer discussion.
Yeah.
With regard to the EPA, as I said, clearly they are the ones responsible for the regulatory arena, but we will certainly be happy to collaborate in technology and analysis. In fact, I mentioned earlier, we are collaborating on the water issues involving fracking.
Quickly, I want to ask you this. Do you agree that the funding mechanism created in the Royalty Trust Fund is an appropriate way to ensure a dedicated funding stream for unconventional and ultra-deepwater natural gas, yes or no?
Well, I think
please.
The
yes or no, please, if you can't say either one, just tell me.
Well, the administration, as you know, has not supported that, but the Energy Security Trust proposed has a very, very similar mechanism.
And you're familiar with Section 999. I know you are, but
I am indeed.
Your background.
I am indeed.
How does Section 999 program fit within and all of the above energy strategy?
Well, I believe the program executed under 999 has been very effective in looking at R&D, and particularly on environmental impacts of unconventional production, ultra-deep, unconventional, onshore, and also helping with research for small producers.
And I close with this. If our nation wants to move closer to energy independence, shouldn't the federal government be pursuing technology solutions to facilitate energy production rather than pursuing regulatory actions that restrict production? I hope you'll say yes, and if you don't, why, it's okay. I thank you, and I yield back my time.
I think we should do both.
Okay. Thank you. We have great hopes for you, to tell you the truth,
thank
and
you,
want to be supportive of you.
Thank you, sir. And I'd be happy to follow up with our longer discussion.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. And now, Ms. Edwards from Maryland.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Secretary, for being with us here today. Over the couple of years that I've been on this committee, we have been round and round about climate change. Is there human causes to climate change, and what do we do about it? And so I just want to get really clear for the record. Mr. Secretary, do you disagree with any of the scientific conclusions of the vast majority of the climate science community, that an increase in CO2 in the atmosphere leads to a warming of the Earth's surface temperature?
I certainly agree with that, yes.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. And again, to be clear for our record, we've heard from economists, lobbyists, lawyers, lots of folks, not a lot of climate scientists, but I wonder what your response is to the argument that mankind cannot impact the climate, or that several thousand scientists signed a letter indicating that climate change is not real.
I think there's no dispute in my, as I said earlier, that anthropogenic activity has been a major contributor to the recent global warming.
Great. Hope we put that to rest so we don't have to revisit it over and over again in this committee. And then I want to ask you about renewables, because in Maryland, we just incentivized a program for offshore wind capacity, and I wonder how the department is engaging with states that have made these commitments to boosting solar, wind, and other renewable energy sources. And if you have a comment, if you will, about I have a pet peeve about electric vehicles, and it's that our Department of Energy and other departments haven't actually worked with local planners and regional planners to develop the kind of infrastructure that we need to fully implement these new technologies. And then I wonder if you could also comment on the impact, you know, as we see an increase in production of natural gas, the impact on our ability to commit the resources that we need in an environment where a lot of fuel costs are pretty stable, and so we don't have the anxiety about energy in the same way, and how that impacts your ability to drive an agenda that is, results in us making investment in technologies for energy efficiency.
Thank you. There's several questions there, I think. Well, first of all, let me say that I think offshore wind is a very important area to pursue. Costs are still significantly too high, but it's a great wind resource, and especially if we can push out to deeper waters. And we do have work going on in that area. Secondly, you mentioned it in the context of EVs, but more broadly, I've been very clear, I think, in my confirmation process and more recently, that one of my goals is to significantly upgrade our interaction with states and localities. In fact, I've I feel that if you look at our country, different regions have very, very different energy opportunities and needs, and I think we need to do more recognition of that so that we can work with regions and develop the appropriate approaches to a future low-carbon economy. The third, natural gas and the implications of natural gas. Again, I view the natural gas bounty that we have as a real opportunity and a plus. I believe it's an opportunity ultimately for getting that bridge to a low carbon future. In fact, one of the things we I think have not done enough of is looking at the integration of renewables, wind and solar, with natural gas, which is a good way of balance, in the absence of affordable storage so far, a very, very good way of balancing supply and demand. So clearly, the natural gas bounty and low-cost natural gas has very much changed the marketplace, and that's why, in fact, we have lower CO2 emissions. It's the substitution of gas for coal. It's also revitalized much of our manufacturing sector. So I think the issue is to integrate gas, recognize gas as part of the solution going forward. In the meantime, what's critical is continuing the investments in innovation, because what we have to do, just like gas prices have come down, we have to lower the costs of alternative technologies.
All right. Thank you very much. Mr. Chairman, I yield.
Thank you. Mr. Neugebauer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Mr. Secretary. It's good to have you here. In lobbying for his clean energy agenda, President Obama frequently states that the U.S. should follow the clean energy examples set by other countries such as Germany and Spain. However, in Germany, the cost of electricity has risen nearly 40% in the last 5 years, and electricity prices for industry are 15% higher. And the average for other countries in European, 15% higher than the average in other European countries. And just last week, German Chancellor Angela Merkel announced at an energy conference in Berlin that spiraling costs of renewable energy are damaging the country's economic competitiveness and need to be scaled back. Spain is expected to announce next week cuts between 10 and 20% to its subsidies for wind and solar projects. The UK has already trimmed some of the low energy subsidies. It's now saying that European Union's target of getting 20% of its energy from renewable sources by 2020 was a costly mistake. So what have we learned from the Europeans?
Well, I think there are certainly some important areas that we can learn from, although clearly I think the most important thing is what we do here at home in terms of our own energy policy. But as one example, you mentioned Germany, I would give two examples from Germany. One is, and they're both driven in a certain sense by their approach to standards. Their building efficiency is certainly extremely good, and that saves them a lot of money, especially when the costs are high for electricity. Another area where they are frankly much better off than we are is in the so-called soft costs for things like installing solar, 40% of our costs. So I think there's lessons we can learn there as well.
But, you know, I think one of the issues is we're pursuing an agenda that's really being detrimental in many cases to the consumers of this. So I think one of the things that we want to be extremely concerned about is making sure that we let the marketplace determine what are the best alternatives and not the government. I would like now to yield some additional time to the chair, Mr. Rohrbacher from California. I think he wanted a follow-up question.
Yes, thank you very much. Just to note, with your earlier statement about the intensity of weather conditions and how that reflects to an overall climate of the Earth, I heard a story about a week or so ago about the ship that they found in the Great Lakes, and it had disappeared, I think, in 1910. Do you remember that?
No, I did not.
Okay, it was a big story. Uh-huh. And that ship sank in 1910 in one of the great storms of 1910. And ships disappeared to, you know, in Great Lakes and elsewhere. Mm-hmm. And it was interesting that we had such a massive storm in 1910, which indicates that we are not now going through massive storms that are any different than massive storms that we had in the past. Roger Pelkey, I think is how you pronounce his name.
Pelkey.
Dr. Pelkey, thank you very much. Head of at the Colorado State, has done a study of the statistics and says, yes, floods have not increased. Hurricane frequency in terms of their landfall or intensity have not increased. The tornadoes, especially the strongest ones, have not increased, at least since the 1950s, when we had many of these tornadoes. Drought has not drought has actually decreased since the middle of the century, since especially the 1930s. East Coast storms, there's no trend there. And he said, quite frankly, that this idea that we are now, every time a heavy storm comes through and we get it, see it on TV, for someone to suggest that this is something new, that it's wrong. I mean, we have always had these intense storms. That's part of living on the planet.
I certainly agree that we've always had these intense storms. I think, and there is certainly here, there is more scientific discussion needed than in some of the other areas. But the issue is, in many very reputable scientists analyzing the data, not tornadoes, but more in cyclones, because of the water issue. It's the statistics. It's not any individual.
Okay. And you are aware that my colleague Ms. Edwards unfortunately is gone. That when we've heard this over and over again, the overwhelming number of scientists disagree that it's man-made activity that's causing this increase in temperature, which I believe the temperature has stayed steady for 16 years now.
That's in dispute.
Okay, all right. Do you think the Russian Academy of Sciences is to be taken seriously?
I would not offer an opinion.
All right. Well, I hope that while you are in your office, that the Russian Academy of Sciences is someone that you would be conferring with. They totally reject this theory, and I was just over there recently, spent a day with the scientists over there and talking to them. And one last thing in terms of wind and the rest of them, aren't there a lot of birds that are killed by these windmills as well? I mean, I understand more birds are killed by these wind power. There's an attempt to use wind power than we have polar bears in Alaska or in the Arctic.
I wouldn't know how to compare that, but I must say if I go back to the what I tried to emphasize is that where I'm coming from is actually much simpler. We know what the radiative forcing of carbon dioxide is. We've known that again since the 19th century. We know how that translates into average temperature increase. We know how much CO2 is emitted from anthropogenic sources. We know how much CO2 remains in the atmosphere. And this is all consistent with a track that would have us in the multiple degree centigrade average global warming. Mm-hmm. The more one goes into localized expectations of consequences, the more scientific debate there is.
Well, thank you.
But the macro is just clear by counting.
Well, while those charts, you're looking at the charts, do they also juxtapose solar activity, like solar flares and solar things? That also may have an impact, but
it's a long discussion.
We'll have a long discussion on that. Mr. Bera.
You know, thank you, and thank my colleague from California for letting me jump ahead. Dr. Moniz, thank you for being here today. My questions are simple. You know, the public expects us to address issues and solve problems, so I'll ask some simple questions. Dr. Moniz, do you believe that the climate is changing?
Yes, I do.
Okay. And do you believe that regardless of percentages, that there are both natural causes of climate change as well as human causes of climate change?
Certainly.
And do you believe that, given the trajectory that we're on, that at some juncture the climate change is going to become irreversible or be very difficult to manage?
Well, yes, because basically carbon dioxide stays in the atmosphere for many, many centuries, so it's cumulative. And, yes, we've kind of set the agenda for decades in advance already.
And the longer we delay dealing with this, the more difficult it'll be.
Correct.
So given that, and given that all of us agree that you're one of the most qualified scientists, you know, the Senate overwhelmingly confirmed you, do you think our focus should be on those areas that we can actually impact climate change, which would be the human causes of climate change?
Well, yes, I think we should. I think prudence calls for us to take prudent steps today, and I might add that the difference of the anthropogenic over these last decades is the rapidity with which we are. It's not a natural timescale the way we are increasing CO2 emissions.
Great. So this body can debate percentages. They can debate causes, but we all acknowledge that regardless of the percentage, there's a human factor here that leads to increased CO2.
Well, I certainly am a very strong one in my view.
That impact our ability. Giving us advice, what recommendations would you like to see this body enact and the administration enact so we start to slow this down?
Well, I think certainly for the Department of Energy and for this committee's jurisdiction, I think a key is to really push hard on the science and technology that underpins a transition over time to a low-carbon economy. I mean, I think that's the innovation agenda. And as I've said, I think not all of my entrepreneurial friends like this, but I think the fundamental goal of this innovation is cost reduction of these technologies so that they will all be marketplace competitive and drive. The policy will be a lot easier with lower costs.
And specific recommendations for how we actually reduce the cost, what you'd like us to see us do?
Well, I think, again, the targets, I think, are across the board efficiency. I mean, efficiency is where today we still have many opportunities that are at least life cycle cost beneficial, whether that's vehicles, buildings, of course, an enormous opportunity, industrial processes. Then we need to go to low-carbon, carbon-free alternatives in the power sector, which is probably the leading sector for getting carbon out of the sector. We have three options. We have nuclear, we have renewables, and we have carbon capture and sequestration. And I believe we need a multi-pronged approach on all of these, and that's what, in fact, the President's budget proposes. That's what we are doing.
Great. As a scientist myself, a life scientist, certainly this is critical. You know, we certainly are seeing the changes that are occurring. Again, the vast majority of the public understands that the climate is changing. The vast majority of the science community understands that the climate is changing. And it is about time that we move past debating percentages and addressing the root cause issue where we can address that root cause issue. So, you know, we on this committee look forward to working with you. We look forward to working with the administration, and we look forward to working with the broader community to start addressing our children's future.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Again, because as you're saying, sir, there's a lot to debate in terms of how we address it.
Absolutely. But, you know, we can have that debate on how we address it,
right.
But let's move past the debate of whether the climate's changing or not. We know the climate's changing, and let's focus on those areas where we can have impact and we can actually, you know, ensure our children's future and our grandchildren's future. Thank you, and I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Holtgren.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Dr. Moniz. Very good to have you here, and I really am looking forward to working with you and do feel like this is a pivotal time for so many issues, dealing with science in particular. Mm-hmm. And so I just want to say how much I'm looking forward to that. It's not been a secret that I had some strong disagreements with your predecessor and also with the president, specifically with funding choices. And it's interesting, even the discussion today, and I appreciated your comments in your statement that the challenges we face, specifically some climate challenges, are not just our challenges, it's world challenges. And when you look at the impact, much of it is happening beyond our borders. And questions we have to ask is, at what cost? There's things we can do, but at what cost? And what other things suffer when we have limited resources? So that is the type of debate we need to be having, and I'm looking forward to having that debate with you as well. I have really have been frustrated where I feel like some important scientific work, specifically with our national laboratories, has been undercut under this administration, and the opportunity to continue that funding and that priority and how it all fits in. I talk about really an ecosystem of science and how our laboratories and our universities mm-hmm. and our commitment to STEM education all fit together with ultimately what type of nation are we going to be? Are we going to be an innovative nation, cutting edge nation? That's what I want to make sure during my time here, whether that's short or long, and I hope to be able to work with you on that and finding areas where we can agree to move that forward.
Me too.
I do want to start questioning of really asking about DOE stewardship in discovery sciences. As you know, the DOE is responsible for things like particle physics, excuse me, my tongue isn't working today, that are not immediately related to its energy mission but have a long history of successes in improving our understanding of the universe. How will you make sure that we maintain the vitality of these fields and remain among the world leaders in things like high energy physics at a time when the overwhelming priority of the department has been on subsidizing existing energy technologies and addressing climate change?
Well, I believe these, as you call them, discovery sciences are an absolutely critical part of our stewardship. I think the I mentioned you mentioned particle physics. This is a place where, and this is also my approach, where frankly I think the community needs to come together and decide what is the next direction. Clearly. The center of high energy physics right now is in Geneva, but Fermilab, for example, is emphasizing some precision physics and high intensity physics. Is that the direction we go? So, Congressman, I think the community has a so-called snowmass meeting this summer, which happens to be in Minneapolis,
not quite snowmass.
But I think that that is a critical meeting because, frankly, I think the particle physics community has not had as clear a strategic plan in the last years as some of the other fields have had.
Well, I agree with you, and I really do appreciate what you had said earlier, too, with my colleague from Illinois, Mr. Lipinski, of the work that you're doing of bringing lab directors together to make sure that we have a strategy, that we're not just floundering. And also there's been times where we've kind of pitted labs against other labs. Mm-hmm. I don't believe it should ever be that way. Mm-hmm. It's one of the reasons we started up the National Science and Laboratories Caucus, is just to help educate other members of how important these are and how each play an important role. We need to hold them accountable with the funds they have, but let's make sure that we are committed to them and telling the story among ourselves and to the world of how important this is. You mentioned, and my time's going to run out, but you mentioned how the focus of physics really has changed and focused on Geneva, and that's part of the discussion we have to have as well is big projects, big science projects, and how we're going to do that into the future. I want to have that discussion also and look forward to maybe a time where we could sit down hopefully and talk about that. In my last remaining seconds, I do want to switch gears to something else you talked about in your opening statement, and that was recent news from China on the fastest computer coming out of China. I'm currently working with several of my colleagues on this committee on legislation that will reauthorize some of the department's high-speed computing research programs to push us towards the exascale of computing systems. With that news out of China, where do you think we there are opportunities to shift funding at the DOE where we could get more bang for our buck with exascale computing instead of existing expenditures in other areas? And to what extent would you hope to coordinate the activities of the Office of Science with NASA on some of that work?
That's a very interesting question. First of all, we are well along in putting together an exascale plan that we hope to bring to the Congress shortly. I think, by the way, a key direction for the United States in this kind of international competition is to lower the energy requirements dramatically.
Absolutely agree.
I mean, our target is like a 20-megawatt exascale machine and not a gigawatt exascale machine. So that's an example of a very important area. I think working with NASA could be very interesting. By the way, not only on that as an enabling technology, but another place is robotics. I think where we could have a lot more use of robotics in our difficult nuclear security and cleanup missions, and NASA, of course, is a pioneer there.
Good. Well, I wondered if maybe I could get a copy of the bill we're working on to get your thoughts on that, the exascale computing bill that we're going to be presenting here in the next couple of days. And you're right, there are some significant challenges. I know just the Chinese system, I think it's got over 3 million cores and about 18,000 kilowatts of power. So these are the challenges we're going to have to face to really get to exascale. But I know we can do it, but I want to be intentional on that and strategic,
right,
whether it's with the labs or whether it's with our computing. So thank you. I look forward to working with you.
Thank you.
I do hope it's positive. I think this is a pivotal time. With that, I yield back. Thank you for your generous.
And if I may just comment, I wasn't aware of this caucus with the labs, and I'd be happy to meet with that.
We'd love to have you. It's bipartisan, and we are working together across the aisle, seeing how this is important and how we really haven't done as good of a job as we should of telling the stories of what our labs have done and continue to do and how important they are. So thank you. I yield back.
Thank you. And I'm going to have to, unfortunately, give up this gavel. And Ms. Loomis, who is the chairman of the Energy Subcommittee here on Science and Technology, will be taking the chair. But in the meantime, Ms. Bonamici from Oregon will have her time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Dr. Muniz, for your testimony today. I'm going to ask about three issues, electric vehicles, solar energy, especially domestic manufacturing, and wave energy. And because my time is short, I'm going to ask the three questions and then give you time to respond. I was pleased to see significant increases in the energy efficiency and renewable energy budget proposal, particularly in the area of vehicle technologies. Oregon is a national leader in this area. We have a high number of electric vehicles. In fact, your department recently found that in Oregon, the cost to operate an electric vehicle is the equivalent of running on gasoline that costs 96 cents a gallon. I think many of my colleagues would appreciate that in their districts. So can you describe the department's plans to replicate this type of success in other communities that don't yet have the same deployment levels as my state of Oregon? And then secondly, on solar energy, you highlight solar energy as a priority. I'm glad to see this reflected in a proposed budget increase. In my district in Oregon, we have Solar World employing about 800 people, providing the installation industry with a high-quality product while also supporting domestic manufacturing. But Solar World's ability to compete domestically is being threatened. Last year, the International Trade Commission unanimously found that U.S. solar manufacturers have been injured by unfair trade practices. So will you please discuss the impact of such trade practices, especially on domestic solar manufacturing, and can the Department of Energy do more to support domestic manufacturing? Finally, Oregon has made a strategic decision to work with the federal government to become an international leader in wave energy. Many countries, especially in Europe, have already deployed viable operating electricity generating projects using the emission-free power of ocean waves and currents and tidal forces. In fact, the UK has spent more than $780 million US dollars on wave energy R&D over the past decade. I believe it's critical that the United States send a clear signal to the rest of the world that we're a strong competitor in and serious market for this emerging sector. There's a need for some investment related to development of an offshore testing center, which I, of course, hope will be in Oregon. And wonder, does the department plan to pursue an increase for water and wave power in the FY15 budget request to Congress? Thank you very much, and please respond in the remaining time.
Thank you. So first on the electric vehicles, let me actually first note that in the 2011 Department of Energy Quadrennial Technology Review, the lead recommendation was to shift emphasis relatively speaking, more towards advanced vehicle technologies, and that's reflected now in the FY14 budget. That quadrennial technology review is the first step towards the quadrennial energy review that I mentioned earlier, which I hope will have similar consequences on a broader playing field. In terms of the deployment of electric vehicles, clearly today the number of vehicles deployed is modest, but the rate of deployment is actually faster than it was for hybrids at this stage of their deployment, and partly it's because they are really high performance vehicles. A little bit expensive at the moment, but high, very, very high performance. The e-gallon you referred to in terms of the operating costs of such a vehicle, in your state it was below a dollar. The national average is $1.14, and we have a tool now where somebody can find the price of operating a vehicle the same way they can at the local gas station and seeing the price price up there. So the goal here is A, get the capital cost down for the batteries, B, in programs like our Clean Cities and our strengthened emphasis on states and localities that I'm bringing in, and I can't say right now, but I think you will have an excellent person will be coming in to head this. She's very, very been very prominent in state energy issues, that we will be looking to help localities in terms of the infrastructure infrastructure development. Secondly, on solar, clearly, I mean, many policy instruments are not in the realm of the Department of Energy, but what I would say is, of course, again, we come back to the cost reduction, not only in the, let's say, a module per se, but in the manufacturing processes, very, very important. The President's manufacturing initiative, I think, is going to be very important here. Advanced materials. The new one that's up for bid right now involves power electronics. That's part of a system for solar. And again, working with the states, we got to find a way to get the soft costs down, right, which right now are driving things very, very heavily. On what was the third? Wave and tidal energy. That's a program that I have to say I have not yet gotten to review. I know it's a small program right now. I have received strong encouragement to look at what have been called the forgotten renewables beyond wind and solar, and that would be waves, micro hydro, geothermal. So we will be looking at that in the FY15 budget preparation. Clearly, I can't make a commitment on any specific number now.
Terrific. Thank you very much. My time has expired. We look forward to working with you, and I yield back, Madam Chairwoman.
I thank the gentlelady, and I wish to add my warm welcome to you, Secretary Moniz. Next, you'll be hearing from the gentleman from Indiana, Dr. Bouchon.
Thank you, and thanks for being here. A couple of questions that I have about worldwide CO2 emissions. What percentage of the world's CO2 emissions from a human source come from the United States? Do you have any idea?
Oh, it's, I'd say, approaching 20%.
About 20%.
We're number two after China, right?
Okay. So if we hypothetically eliminated all CO2 emission in the United States, would that have any effect on the world, on the global atmospheric CO2 situation?
Well, it certainly would, because I believe it would be in the context of others doing the same.
Okay. And you think, what's the likelihood you think that others would do the same as some of the things that are being proposed?
Well, I think, you know, I'm cautious about speculating. I think what we need to do is to take care of our business, lower the costs of low carbon technologies,
yeah,
and create industries, hopefully, that can be profitable in selling to the world as the world goes to low carbon. So I think we have plenty of incentives, but clearly, in the end, we need to bring along all the major emitters.
Right. So the question I have, I mean, first of all, I do believe the climate in the world is changing. I'm just very skeptical about the role of human CO2 production in that, based on historical climate change over the course of the history of the world. And so Do you think that the United States should economically disadvantage itself with that end goal when it's pretty clear to me that it's very unlikely the rest of the world will do what you're proposing to do?
I think we should advantage ourselves, and then we may have a discussion about what it sure. means to advantage ourselves today, 10 years from now, 30 years from now. The energy scene, no matter what the drivers are, is not going to look the same as it does today. And I think we need to have a robust.
Now that's your opinion, or do you have how do you know that?
That's my opinion.
That's your opinion. Okay.
And I would say, sir, if I may, that I think when we look back in time, 10 years, 20 years, we're always amazed at how the world looks so different. But when we look forward, we tend to think it's going to look just the same.
Yeah. Can I talk about Germany right now? What's Germany doing with their energy production? What's the currently, I mean, what are they doing, for example? Do you have any idea?
Germany has, of course, one thing is they are phasing out their nuclear power.
Right, which you're proposing that we use as a different source in the United States. So why are they phasing that out?
In my view, it's their decision.
And what are they phasing in?
The issue was what they phase in, exactly.
Yeah. They're phasing in coal-fired power plants.
And right
is
now,
that true or not true?
There's some additional coal and a lot of additional gas.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you know...
I'm sorry, and wind also.
Yeah, I understand. Yeah. Do you know, have any idea where venture capital is going when it comes to renewable energy sources? Do you know private investment, venture capital... Because what they're doing as it relates to wind and solar right now, do you have any idea?
Well, I think it's come down a bit from the peak, but it's still a pretty large.
And why would that? Why would private sector venture capital be leaving renewables? And I'm not saying I'm against renewables because I'm for everything. Okay.
Well,
but why would that be?
Well, I don't know in detail. I mean, certainly one of the issues has been the large uncertainties in the wind case around the tax.
You may or may not agree that it's because that at this point in our history, they're not economically viable and without the massive federal government infusion of cash into those industries. Is that true or not true?
Wind certainly in many cases is competitive. In fact, earlier the gentleman from Texas raised an issue. Well, just recently our site, DOE site Pantex, signed a fixed power purchase agreement with Siemens from a wind farm, and they are saving $30 million.
Okay, my point
the
is
wind is competitive.
I think that, you know, from an R&D standpoint, I would probably agree that continued R&D in these areas is critically important going forward. Mm-hmm. The question is are we getting ahead of ourselves by at this point without R&D showing that these are economically viable, getting ahead of ourselves essentially when venture capital is leaving those areas of our economy, should the federal government, other than R&D in those areas, continue to put this kind of money into those when it's clear that the private sector and venture capital are leaving them because they're not economically viable? That's the bottom line.
Well, as I've said, we clearly agree on the R&D. But today, costs are dropping, and in many instances are already competitive. That's not a universal statement, but in many instances competitive. That's both wind, the Pantex example is one, and solar, particularly when solar is helping to shave peaks at times of large demand.
My time's expired. Thank you very much.
I thank the gentleman, and now you'll have some questions from the ranking member of the Energy Subcommittee, the gentleman from California, Mr. Swalwell.
Thank you, Chairman Lummis, and welcome, Dr. Moniz. I'm actually very glad you're here because I had a town hall in my district on Saturday back in the Bay Area of California. And a number of my constituents could not believe that in this committee, some of my friends on the other side still have questions and deny that humans play a role in climate change. So their questions here today illustrate that I am not crazy, that is still a debate in this committee. And I put up for you on the screen something from the NASA website called Climate Change, How Do We Know? And there's a graph there of CO2 parts per million on the left side of the graph, and on the bottom side you see over the period of time starting about 400,000 years ago going up to about 25,000 years ago, you see a spike. And then, of course, it really spikes around where 1700 would be. And I'm wondering, is there any correlation between the Industrial Revolution and the CO2 parts per million in that graph?
Well, it's quite direct, actually.
And what's the correlation, Dr. Moniz?
It's a very positive correlation.
Right. And what can we assume the cause of the CO2 parts per million going up?
Well, this is exactly what I was referring to earlier in terms of, roughly speaking, counting CO2 molecules. We know how many molecules are emitted. We know how many are in the atmosphere. It tracks quite closely.
And Dr. Moniz, do 97% of scientists, climate scientists, agree that climate warming trends over the past century are very likely due to human activities?
Yes, I've seen 97-98% as numbers. Right? Mm-hmm. I'm not sure how that number's arrived at, but yes. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. And Dr. Moniz, are you familiar with the National Ignition Facility at Lawrence Livermore Laboratory?
Yes, in general terms. I have not had yet a chance to drill down into it since I've been in the office the last 3 weeks. But
well, better than drill down, I'd like to invite you to come visit the facility. It's in my district. It's also in wine country, so after the tour, we'd be happy to show you around. But
for the tour?
Do you support the National Ignition Facility's dual goal of maintaining our nuclear weapons stockpile and providing scientists with the physics understanding necessary to create fusion ignition and energy gain for future energy production?
Well, I mean, I have to say, I think clearly the principal purpose of the facility has been for stockpile stewardship, and even without ignition, which remains a goal for a few years from now, presumably, that has to be the major focus. Now, clearly, a lot of that work, certainly getting to ignition, will by definition be useful for the ICF purpose.
And you mentioned that just this past week, Oak Ridge's supercomputer is no longer the world's fastest. Mantle, once again claimed by China. Does it trouble you that Russia and China are also beginning to outpace us when it comes to fusion ignition projects?
Well, I think it's more of an across-the-board issue. I think, you know, we're in a different world, highly competitive in terms of technology innovation, and we just got to keep out in front.
Would you agree, then, that the President's fiscal year 2014 budget request for the National Ignition Facility, a cut of $110 million, will set us back in achieving ignition and will cede leadership in the area of fusion ignition to Russia and China?
Well, clearly there were lots of difficult choices to be made, and the Department of Defense, with Department of Energy and OMB, just felt that the needs in stockpile stewardship and stockpile reliability just had to be met in a very tough budget environment.
And Dr. Moniz, the Lawrence Livermore National Lab Director has told me and Congresswoman Lofgren, who has also been an advocate and champion for fusion ignition, that if the President's budget for NIF stands, it will essentially either shut down NIF or set back all of its major goals by at least 10 years. Since NIF began operating in 2009, they were a factor of 1,000 away from achieving ignition. Today, they are a factor of 10 away, which would be equivalent of taking a road trip from Denver, driving to San Francisco, and then when you get to Oakland, deciding to stop and turn around and go back to Denver. So my question is, will you let NIF shut down on your watch, or will we see it continue to march forward toward ignition?
Well, I'll have to talk with Mr. Albright about that statement. Certainly the intent is to have NIF, we need it strongly engaged, certainly in our stockpile stewardship program.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Moniz, and thank you for interpreting that graph on the fly without any warning ahead of time. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
And I yield back the balance of my time. Thank you, Chair Lummis.
I thank the gentleman and the ranking member, and I hope that you will include us on this tour that you were discussing with the Secretary. next is the gentleman from Arizona, Mr. Schweikert.
Madam Chairwoman, is it the tour or the wine country part?
The former and the latter, yes.
Yeah, it is an incredible machine.
Hey, Mr. Secretary, first off, congratulations. You have actually one of the positions in government that, on a personal basis, I find absolutely fascinating because of the things you get to touch and influence. But you've actually seen some of the nature of the conversation here today. And I come with you at you from a certain philosophy saying, you know, the arrogance of really smart people, sometimes we think we know more than we do. If I were to hop in the literature right now and go back a dozen years ago, whether it be you or many of the smart people you hang around with, what would you have written about peak oil? The fact of the matter is the next incremental barrel of oil, you know, much of the literature in the very late 90s, very early 2000s, made it very clear there the next incremental barrel of oil or fossil fuels would be less. Small problem is we got it wrong. And we built tax codes here, we built environmental codes, we built regulatory codes, actually even foreign policy, based on a premise that was absolutely wrong. I've been very pleased in a couple of your comments saying you are going to try to focus policy on a broad optionality. Mm-hmm. Because the arrogance that you and I know what tomorrow is the great fault around here. And I know this is starting to sound more like a speech, and I don't mean it to. 2007 around here, we all knew that compact fluorescent bulbs were the future, except for the fact they're not. As of, December, LEDs crashed in price, and now I can do LEDs for less money than compact fluorescent. But we had the arrogance that we all knew what the future was. Can I beg of you, as you're doing your policy sets, as you visit with policymakers here, to maximize that discussion? I know you come from a physics background, which is often very linear in thinking, and saying, policy-wise, who knows what's being developed in someone's garage right now that you and I have never thought of that is tomorrow's manufacturing technology mm-hmm. breakthrough? Can I beg of you, with this position you have in the next couple of years, you'll maximize that optionality for the next great breakthrough?
Sir, that's exactly along the lines of what I was trying to emphasize, that I think we don't know the future. We always think of the future, again, as a linear extrapolation of the present, and it's not. And it's those innovations that do so much to change the future. I would just say one thing, however, in terms of peak oil. I have witnesses. I was never a peak oil believer.
You'll be happy to know. I really couldn't. I Googled you, and I did not see you pop up. But I did see the guys just down the hallway from you at MIT writing huge articles about how right now we should be about $200 barrel in oil as of this month.
Well,
didn't even get close.
Certainly predicting oil prices is a loser's game.
Yeah.
On peak oil, I mean, our view was always that
But it is a
it's not molecules you run out of. It's at what cost can you get the molecules?
But you have to agree, it's right. A brilliant example of technology is faster moving and smarter than we are because someone out there is coming up with it. It's, you know, when I hold up the book of, you know, the population bomb, right, from 1968. The only thing they got right was the author's name. Everything in the book got wrong. Because the arrogance of not knowing what the next breakthrough is.
And also, just to reinforce your point, in natural gas, of course, it was very recently when major heads of major corporations not only got it wrong, but put their money in the wrong place.
But that's the beauty of markets. Look,
right.
For just a bit of fun trivia before I bounce on my next really important thing, what's the only major industrialized country not to sign the Kyoto Accords? What's the only major industrialized country to actually hit its allocation?
Mm-hmm. Well,
because we did not overregulate natural gas. We had massive adoption because we didn't stop it. And all of a sudden, we've hit our Kyoto Accords because of market pressures driving us there, not a command and control regulatory environment. There's one thing I'll do very quickly. You actually have a lot of regulatory authority within your agency over things like shower heads. Believe it or not, I have a little constituent in my district that manufactures frou-frou shower heads. He had enforcement officers from the Department of Energy walk in his door, hit him with a $470,000 fine because the flow restrictor took too little pounds of pressure, if I'm describing that correctly, to yank out. Please be somewhat circumspect on the law enforcement functions you have within your agency. And how they affect small businesses and our communities and our manufacturers. It's one thing to say you need to change the pounds of pressure, to remove the flow restrictor. It's another thing to walk in and hit someone and scare the out of them, you know, with a $470,000 fine. And with that, I yield back.
Thank the gentleman, and the gentleman from California, Mr. Tucano, is next.
I thank the chairwoman, Ms. Loomis. Thank you, Secretary Moniz, for your testimony before the committee this morning. I was thinking about a joke I could make about 98% of the scientists and how my side of the aisle stands with the 98% versus the 2%, alluding to our economy of 98% of the population versus the 2%, but I'm not going to go there, even though I just went there. Anyway, I am fortunate to have a top-notch UC Riverside, a top-notch university research facility. I frequently hear from my constituents and researchers at the university about the key role that the Department of Energy plays in fostering innovation and funding basic research. Since 2009, the UC Riverside has received more than $20 million from the department to fund research ranging from high energy physics to the hormonal regulation of plant growth. This fall, the university plans to open an experimental solar and battery smart grid, the largest at any university in the nation. The smart grid research lab will allow researchers to study innovative ways to improve smart grid power management, link large computing data centers with the grid, study smart grid cybersecurity, and better understand ways to link energy from renewable sources with the grid. And that's just a snapshot of the work being done at UCR. DOE funding has also contributed to biofuels research and solar energy research at Bourne's College of Engineering, which is part of the leading edge of research in pushing down the cost and driving up the efficiency of solar energy collection. This kind of research innovation not only creates jobs, it leads to the scientific breakthroughs that will allow us to face the challenges of the 21st century. And I appreciate hearing from you today about the department's strategy as we work together to meet those challenges. Now, just to be clear, counsel moving forward with the best scientific knowledge that we have. I realize I want to be humble and not presume that we know the future, but 98% or 97% of the scientists do seem to have a consensus that global climate change is real, that the anthropocentric contribution to carbon contribution is coming from human sources. We've already, I don't want to keep beating that drum, but I think we've amply made that point. I want to go to one of my priorities as a former K-12 teacher is STEM education. You mentioned something about 1 million. The Chinese have a goal of 1 million, educating 1 million students in high-performance computing.
High-performance computing.
Can you tell me the significance of that goal, and do you think it is a prudent goal of the Chinese, and what does that pose as a challenge to us as Americans?
Well, I can't judge whether it's prudent or not in China, but it does catch my attention in terms of the importance of training scientists and engineers and mathematicians, et cetera, for our future. Another issue, in fact, I would raise is that I think we need still, after many years of working at it, to do a better job in terms of using all of our talent, women and minorities. Certainly in the energy field, we are not as well represented as we need to be. So I think we need to just keep our eye on the ball. Human resources are the key in the end. We've got to use all of our human resources, and that's something that I certainly would like to work on in the next few years.
I recently run into a high school classmate of mine who was one of the, innovators in terms of all these games that people play on the mm-hmm. internet. Mm-hmm. And he was taken with this idea. This 1 million students caught my attention because he really thinks it would be beneficial if we started as early as pre-kindergarten to teach students the fundamentals of code writing. What do you think about that? Is that something?
I think I'm not qualified to judge on that, but clearly science, mathematics, and computer literacy are just clearly essential skills, I think, for young people to succeed in the future. They can succeed in other things too, but as a country, we need more students succeeding in those areas.
So may I
just add in, sure. one of the things that I have talked about that I would like to look at the department, kind of along these lines, is I think that we may want to look and come to the Congress for discussions at what I would call a traineeship program, where we support, so it's not broad necessarily like scholarships, it's focus on areas of national need where we aren't producing enough young people for our missions. So, for example, in our nuclear security mission, you know, actinide chemistry, for our energy mission, power electronics. So I think that's something that would be a good discussion to have with this committee and other members about mission areas for the department, targeted programs to get more people trained.
This has to be with workforce emphasis. Madam Chair, my time is up. Sorry, I went over.
Can I thank the gentleman and yield to the gentleman from North Dakota, Mr. Kramer.
Thank you, Madam Chair and Madam Ranking Member, and thank you, Mr. Secretary, for being with us and being so generous with your time. I, rather than beating the dead horse, I'm going to accept it for a moment. And I appreciate a couple of things you said. You referred to three priorities of how to deal with or how to push science and technology investment toward a low-carbon economy. You mentioned nuclear, you mentioned renewables, and the third thing you mentioned was carbon capture and sequestration, and I don't think we've spent any time specifically on that today as a priority, and I'd like to explore that. Coming from North Dakota, where we enjoy the lowest electricity prices in the country due to the low cost of coal and the fact that we burn it right there and generate electricity, and the fact that we enjoy a good economy as a result of the very high price of oil, I want to talk about the department's strategy in terms of investment in capturing carbon and using it and injecting it into oil fields for enhanced oil recovery. Your commitment to that, what do you see as that in as a possible future scientifically and in research and development in that arena?
Thank you. Actually, I would say that, in fact, I think 2 years ago, when I was at MIT, with the University of Texas at Austin, we had a workshop specifically on CO2 for enhanced oil recovery. Maybe for others not as familiar, I might just say that today it's not a great and widely known story that we are using today 60 million tons of CO2 annually to produce 300,000 barrels of oil per day from enhanced oil recovery. And, you know, it's a little bit shaky, but an analysis done for the department a few years ago indicates there may be a factor of 10 still to be had. That would be 3 million barrels of oil per day. But to have enough CO2, we need to capture it from power plants or industrial facilities. Today, largely using the stimulus funds of several billion dollars went into, I think we have now six major projects moving forward on carbon capture and storage, and I believe, I can check the exact numbers, but I believe four of those will use enhanced oil recovery. So clearly, getting the economic value of the oil helps you with the cost of capturing the carbon.
Precisely. One of those projects is called the Plains CO2 Reduction Partnership in North Dakota at the University of North Dakota.
Yep. Energy and Environmental Research Center. Head of one of the regional partnerships.
Yes, that's exactly correct. And so I guess I want to use the opportunity to encourage you to continue that investment there, because we really, first of all, geologically there are lots of opportunities, obviously, mm-hmm. and when you have 8 billion or more barrels of recoverable oil at current technology like we have in North Dakota and a 800-year supply of coal that we'd like to burn for a very long time to generate low-cost electricity, if we could find this opportunity to capture that CO2, which we know, understand is a challenge, and yet we do it. We do it quite effectively, up to 50% of it in our coal gasification facility, at least. I would encourage that type of an investment where there's already proven cost-benefit and, as you said, a potential for much, much greater. One other area of
Could I just inject? And, of course, the Great Plains plant you refer to was an old DOE investment.
It certainly was, and, boy, what a history it has. Thank you. One other area I just want to pursue since I have the time is that you've been quite specific about your plans for dealing with LNG export and approving applications for LNG ports on a case-by-case basis, with which seems prudent. But realizing that there are a number of applications in front of you where the comment period has ended and some have been waiting for months, is there any chance of expediting some of that in a responsible way, given the demand in the world and the fact that global markets are, you know, kind of present this window of opportunity for us as a country? Could you just comment a little bit on that, realizing it's a little outside the scope perhaps of
science? That is fundamentally my plan. The second license was granted shortly before I became secretary. As I said in my confirmation process, I needed a few weeks to, and I'm still just 3 weeks, basically, a few weeks to go over the process, look at the inputs, et cetera, not commissioning new studies or anything. I think, you know, we're getting kind of to the place where I think this kind of review, my personal review period is maturing, and then I plan to go expeditiously as I've committed. I understand some of the frustrations and some of the market opportunities, and we also realize that even with a conditional license granted, of course, there's still a lot of work the companies have to do in terms of assembling the capital, getting the customers, getting the suppliers all lined up. So I want to move expeditiously. I've certainly committed to having strong review process this year.
Thank you for your access today and your willingness to be so frank with us. Appreciate it. Thank you. My time's obviously expired.
I thank the gentleman and yield to the gentleman from Washington, Mr. Kilmer.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Mr. Secretary, for joining us today. The administration recently announced its proposal to create a national network for manufacturing innovation, meant to serve as regional hubs for accelerating the development of manufacturing new innovative technologies. The Department of Energy, through its Advanced Manufacturing Office, has played a direct role in supporting these innovative manufacturing initiatives. I've certainly found that when most people think about innovation, they tend to think of Mr. Swalwell's district or Silicon Valley, but even in more rural areas, including my neck of the woods, on the Olympic Peninsula, Washington State, we have advanced composite materials manufacturers that are developing very high-end, high-quality materials that have enormous potential. I was hoping you could speak a little bit about what steps the department is taking to ensure that fair consideration is given to innovation that's taking place in rural areas, where the injection of key support could not only help support our long-term global competitiveness, but could really revolutionize local economies.
Thank you. As you say, the department is a participant along with other agencies in the Advanced Manufacturing Initiative, and have we partnered with DOD and I think a third agency in the 3D printing manufacturing initiative, and we have one out now in large band gap semiconductors. I can certainly assure you that first of all, proposals will certainly be evaluated fairly. From rural areas or others. Number two, that my emphasis on doing more with the states, I think, could lead to a very interesting dialogue about what we can do with maybe to stimulate additional activity in rural places. All I can say today is that I'd be delighted to have that dialogue, and if you have ideas as to how that might go forward, whether it's the manufacturing initiative or other initiatives, I would be delighted to have that conversation.
I thank you for that. I sure appreciate that, and certainly I and my office and a number of other members would, I think, be keen to be part of that.
If there could be a group that we could get together with, that would be great.
Thank you for that. If I may ask also, what role do you see for the national labs in that, also in that broader discussion of impact at the local level in local economies?
Well, okay, let me answer one question you didn't ask and one you did ask.
Sure.
First of all, the labs are connected to this manufacturing initiative. So, for example, in the 3D printing, there's a pilot scale project at Oak Ridge. And, of course, now we have the manufacturing facility in Ohio there. In terms of your question, I have spoken with the labs already, the lab directors. I mentioned earlier I've met with them about because we are going to be developing this kind of quadrennial energy review process with a much more state and regional focus, while our labs don't cover quite the entire country, I would like them to become centers of that regional outreach. So that's a process we're going to have to invent. It isn't really there now that well, but we have to do that. That's number one. Number two is when it comes to technology transfer from the laboratories, I'll be honest, I think it is not at a level that we should expect. I think we need to do more. I believe part of that will also come by working with the states, because I think it's the innovation ecosystem you need around the lab then to draw all those technologies out. So that's kind of in general terms the kind of vision I have, at least, for this.
I think that's very true, and certainly in my part of the world, you'd find a private sector that'd be very interested in having stronger integration between the lab and private industry.
Yeah, that'd be great. Again, we'd love to follow up on that.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. I yield back.
I thank the gentleman. Mr. Secretary, it is 8 minutes past noon. Are you able to hang in there with us for a few more minutes?
Oh, a few more minutes, I'm sure.
Thank you very much. The gentleman from Texas has graciously yielded to his place in the queue to the gentleman from Utah, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman, and thank you, Mr. Weber, for allowing me to jump in here. Mr. Secretary, thank you for being here. Once in a while, you'll read someone's resume, and you think, wow, that guy's a lot smarter than I am. And
don't believe what you read.
Well, this is, unlike climate change, this is a matter of fact, not speculation, and your resume is really quite impressive. I worked a little bit in the energy and the environment sector. I'm not an expert on it. I've never claimed to be, but I do know a little bit about it. And I think by far the most important story that we see in the energy world right now, it's not wind, it's not solar, it's not biomass, it's really hydraulic fracking. That has changed the energy world, and frankly has changed the world in very significant ways. It's reshaped the energy map, and I was a former military officer, and I can tell you that from a strategic point of view, it's changed the way that I think we view many of the challenges that we face from not just an energy sector, but also from a national security point of view. Mm-hmm. Just one comment on that. U.S. will surpass Saudi Arabia and also Russia to become the top global oil producer in the next decade. I think that's great news for us. But, Mr. Secretary, by DOE's own report, very, very little of this increased production has happened on federal lands. I come from Utah. There are some counties in my district that are 97% controlled by the federal government. And many of these counties have enormous natural resources. They have resources there that we could be taking advantage of, but they unfortunately don't lie on state lands or federal land, or private lands. They lay underneath federal lands. And I'm wondering, would you commit to us that you would be willing to work with, DOE would be willing to support greater access to federal lands to take advantage of some of these natural resources?
Well, sir, I think, first of all, of course, as you've said, our production overall is going up dramatically. With regard to the federal lands, that's clearly something for the Department of the Interior and not something that we have
right.
any direct engagement with.
I understand that, but I'm just wondering, with your background and with your expertise, would you say that would be an appropriate response for us to try to encourage the federal government to make more available on these federal lands?
Well, I think, the President is supports all of the above, and I think the issue is to see that we continue to grow our domestic production.
Okay. And thank you for that, and I hope the President takes that approach as well. And then one other comment very quickly, knowing that you're extending your time. And this is not something that involved you directly, knowing that you are, of course, new in your position. And by the way, enjoy, I think, broad bipartisan support. And the vote that you had for your nomination, I think, is an indicator of that. But one thing that I think troubled several of us was this idea of the capital cronyism. If you go back and look over the last 4 years, the cylinders of the world. And if you look at the very, very high percentage of those people, those companies that had renewable energy companies that were backed by the Energy Department, and by some reports, as much as 80% of them were run by or primarily owned by Obama financial backers. And I'm just wondering if you would respond to that and tell me if you think that's a great idea, which I'm supposing you don't, and make a commitment once again that there would be not a political influence that would be played in some of these financial backings that the department takes.
Well, first of all, I think I want to start by referring back to the Allison report that suggested that the program, in fact, has been quite well run. And I have to say, in my 3 weeks, I've been impressed with the quality of the people recruited, their financial knowledge in terms of the loan program. Clearly, we have to evaluate the loans on loan grants on their merits. Of course, right now, much of the job is really stewarding the loans that have been made. As I noted earlier, there are still some outstanding issues like the loan for the loan commitment made for the nuclear power plants in Georgia. And a possible additional FOA that we might do in fossil that we are considering.
I think you and I can agree, though, that if it's true in the previous 4 years that 80% of these companies had some type of financial ties to the president, that would be an inappropriate measuring stick to whether they would receive DOE funds.
Well, the motivation for the award clearly has to be
on the merits of the
project.
Thank you. Right. Thank you for that, because that's obviously very true. And I'm going to cede the last 8 seconds of my time. And thank you, Madam Chairman.
Thank you.
The gentleman from Massachusetts thanks you kindly, and we now turn to him.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Mr. Secretary, it's a pleasure to see you. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for
your constituent.
Yes, I know. I'm thrilled about that. I hope you are, too. But nevertheless, we have a bit of a similar background. We both went to Stanford. I hesitate to compare my physics report card with yours, but nevertheless, glad to see you where you sit, and glad that I'm here as well. So two questions and really one point. I'll start with the point first. Intrigued a little bit, Mr. Secretary, by your response to one of my colleagues' questions earlier about STEM and the importance of STEM education, really for that foundation going forward for that next generation of engineers and that skill set that we need for whatever those jobs of the future are. Very intrigued by that training program. The district that I represent, you're very familiar with. Span the spectrum in terms of economic outlook. Massachusetts has struggled a bit getting the low skill to middle skill. Well, we've done well with the middle skill to the high skill. So would be thrilled to learn more about and support any of those efforts that you have for a mentorship or trainee program. So please just keep us in mind as that develops. Now for the two questions. First, and Mr. Secretary, MIT, as you mentioned and you spoke about this briefly, it's home to one of the world's foremost plasma fusion energy science programs, the MODC facility, which I had the pleasure of touring a couple of months ago. Ultimately, the administration's FY14 budget request terminates that facility, and while proposing an overall increase to the FY13 enacted levels, the increase in funding request will support the U.S. contribution to the ITER, or the ITER International Fusion Project. I know the sensitivities around this, given your former position at MIT, but I just wanted to ask generally your thoughts about the importance of making investments in fusion energy and what that means for that all-of-the-above energy outlook that you talked about going forward, if you can.
Thank you. Well, okay, respectfully, I cannot answer anything with regard to the specifics of the program.
Understood.
General counsel has recused me from that. In general, in terms of fusion, I think fusion is – actually, I should say fusion and plasma science, I think, are an important area for continued DOE support. Plasma science really is another kind of phase of matter, and then fusion has a long-term, and it is still long-term, a possibility as an attractive energy source. So I support the general idea of continuing fusion research, for sure.
And again, Mr. Secretary, keeping it general, as you said, those long-term investments, we still, just because it is a long-term horizon doesn't mean that we don't make the investment. Would you agree?
No, we have to. If we don't make it today, we won't have it in the future.
I would agree with you. And second, building off a little bit of what you said, sir, you've talked quite a bit about, and there's been numerous questions today, about that all-of-the-above energy strategy. The FY 14 administration budget includes $2.78 billion for the Office of Energy Efficiency and Renewable Energy, which proposes a number of increases to its programs across the board. You also mentioned in your testimony, sir, the Race at the Top initiative as part of your larger focus on national energy policy. If, in a, you touched upon this a little bit earlier, sir, but if there are parts of our across-the-board energy portfolio that are not yet cost-competitive because of barriers to technological advancement, how would you propose going forward to lower those barriers to make them, in fact, technologically, to make the technological advancements to make it cost-effective?
Well, I think we need a, as we, I think, have, a portfolio of instruments. At the foundation is the basic R&D, which gives us the new possibilities. But then, of course, we have something like ARPA-E, which takes promising but still high-risk technologies and moves them, hopefully, to the place where they become market attractive for investors, and I think we're seeing a lot of success now developing there. And that the program is still new. I mean, it's about 3.5 years old. Well, going on 4, I guess. So that's very, very encouraging. We also have then programs in the applied energy programs in selected areas for large scale demonstrations. Gentleman from North Dakota, for example, mentioned carbon capture and sequestration. That's a place where demonstrating the viability of large-scale storage is just not credible without DOE, without government investment. And then when it comes to deploying or helping the deployment, then we have things like the loan programs, for example, where. By the way, I didn't get the chance to say this earlier, so I'll say it now. The fact is that this loan portfolio, even if we project with uncertainty on some of the remaining loans going forward, we're talking about no more than 10% loss against the congressionally approved loan loss reserve. That is a pretty good performing portfolio, not to mention things like Tesla paying back $500 million 9 years early, et cetera, et cetera. And by the way, Tesla next year, their announced plan is they're going to become an exporter of vehicles now next year. So it's a great story. But also the world's largest concentrated solar plant in the California desert just had a ceremony a few weeks ago. So I guess our view is that we are moving inexorably, as we have for a century, towards a lower carbon future. And if we want to sit around and not have those technologies develop here, well, we're going to be buyers and not sellers. And I believe that we still are the strongest innovation engine. It's a question of now of capturing that innovation in our marketplace.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. I yield back. Thank you for the time.
I thank the gentleman and yield to the vice chair of our Energy Subcommittee, the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Weber.
Thank you, Madam Chair. They've obviously saved the best to last. So I am from Texas. The vaunted XL Keystone Pipeline would terminate in my district, Mr. Secretary, so we will have a little bit of a discussion about that. Candidate Obama running for president made the statement that under his energy plan, electricity prices would of necessity skyrocket. Do you remember that? You ever seen that video?
No, I did not. But
Google it. It's out there.
Okay. But
so my question to
lower,
you is,
actually.
My question to you is, are you doing everything you can to make electricity prices higher?
Definitely not. As I've said, cost reduction is my principal goal of innovation.
So you're not following the commander-in-chief's edict then that electricity prices need to be higher. So you don't share in that vein of thought, apparently.
I think we need to have energy costs as affordable as possible.
The things that make America great are the things that America makes. And we need a low, stable energy supply, a very reliable one, and I think we've got one. And doing anything to upset that apple cart would obviously be bad for the economy, bad for national security. I'll move on. Politico just reported that Representative Waxman announced in the Energy and Commerce hearing on fossil fuel export issues that climate change should be a key factor in considering LNG export applications. I have two plants, LNG applications in my district. Is the Department of Energy considering climate change in its LNG applications?
As I said earlier, I'm still in the process of getting up to speed. Soon we will be evaluating the dockets. Clearly, the issue is public interest criterion and a set of factors coming in there, environment, economy, security,
That's a great statement. Public interest should be considered. So how would you weight climate change considerations against what I would call economic considerations, or to use yours, public interest? How would you weight those
I think
going forward?
That's something that we'll have to talk about in our order when we issue an order for the license applications.
Have you had these kinds of discussions with climate change with the White House?
On the LNG export issue?
On climate change in general.
Oh, yes, climate change in general, certainly.
How many trips would you say you've made to the White House?
You mean in the last few weeks?
Sure, in the last few weeks, last year, is it two, is it 22?
Three or four times, I presume.
Three or four times. Kind of given the sensitive nature of some of the news reports that have been out lately with some of the revelations, of course, let me just say that, you know, the president said his administration would be the most transparent administration in history. That was his promise, and it seems like it's getting more and more transparent, and it's not very pretty. I want to hold the Department of Energy to account to a higher standard. Some of the discussion has been about the Solyndras in the days behind us, and I know you're going forward as the new secretary. Are you sensitive to the fact that that agency, DOE, I'm talking about in specific, might be used indeed to put pressure on political enemies? Are you sensitive to that fact? In other words, that none of the policies in the DOE would give favoritism toward some of the cronyism that was mentioned here earlier. Have you had that discussion with your staff? Do you have a plan in place to make sure it doesn't happen?
First of all, without talking anything about the past, going forward, I make it very clear we want to be as transparent as possible and as completely open and fair and evaluating everything on the merits.
Well, the last thing we need is there are so many agencies, and you can name them, NSA, IRS, you can go right down the list, that have given the public, American public, such a bad taste. The last thing we need is the Department of Energy or the EPA, which already, I will have to tell you, doesn't have that sterling of a reputation, at least back in my district, because they seem to hamper things more than they help. Last thing we need is that kind of reputation to be further promulgated in your agency. So I would charge you going forward that you make sure it doesn't happen. Let me switch gears. I'm running out of time. You said in some of your comments earlier that you think gas has, and I'm this probably paraphrasing, you said gas has revolutionized the energy industry and should be part of the solution going forward. Natural gas we're talking about.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. We have a unique opportunity in the history of the world for America to take the lead, as you heard earlier from one of my colleagues. Are you committed to doing everything you can to get that permit process moving forward, especially LNG, natural gas, and making it expeditious so that we can maintain our competitive edge, so that we can have that public interest in mind that you yourself talked about?
Well, again, to clarify, I mean, we're not engaged in permitting in terms of production or exploration, but in terms of LNG exports, certainly, and I've said repeatedly, and I intend to be expeditious in going through those cases.
Are you in favor of allowing the Keystone Pipeline to come to the Gulf of Mexico?
That is an issue for the Department of State.
You haven't looked at it at all?
It's not in... Not,
had
not
had no discussions with the President or the White House on it?
No, it is not a responsibility of mine. I have not discussed
okay.
it.
Okay, well, I'm just curious because I want you to do me a favor. When you leave here, I want you to go tell him that we want it in Texas.
Okay, but you already have the bottom half, right?
Madam Chairman, I yield back.
I thank the gentleman, and I thank the Secretary for his enormous patience today. The Chair yields to herself for the final round of questions, my questions are going to revolve around uranium, Mr. Secretary. First of all, does nuclear power add to CO2 emissions?
Yeah, it's essentially carbon-free, right?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I want to visit with you about what has been happening with regard to the domestic uranium industry. Some time ago, a 10% cap was negotiated so that DOE would only transfer, sell, or barter their uranium stockpile at a rate below 10% of current domestic uranium demand. And that agreement was abrogated, and the price of uranium fell through the floor. And my state, which produces a great deal of uranium, albeit domestic supply only supplies 10% of our uranium for our nuclear power needs, was hurt badly, badly by the DOE's decision to abrogate the 10% cap. So I apologize that your predecessor left you holding the bag. But I must ask you now that you're in charge, when does the DOE plan to comply with the law and submit a new management plan?
We are working on that very actively, and I think we can have a plan ready to bring forward fairly soon.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Mm-hmm. You know, the DOE has the authority and the power to make or break uranium production in this country because of prices and their ability to dump excess product on the market and destroy prices here, thereby making our country actually more reliant on foreign providers of uranium. So I strongly encourage you to come and visit Wyoming mm-hmm. and our uranium industry to help you better understand the dramatic direct impact that DOE has on our uranium industry. My next question is about USEC. Over the last 18 months, Dr. Moniz, the taxpayers have been asked to directly subsidize the U.S. Enrichment Corporation to the tune of over $1 billion in cash, free uranium, and other incentives. I want to understand how big this hook is that the taxpayers are hanging on. Specifically, is it DOE or is it USEC who is financially obligated to safely decommission the enrichment facility in Paducah, Kentucky, and hand it over to DOE? And how much do you anticipate that costing?
I cannot give you an exact cost estimate right now, but the USEC will have some responsibilities for the turnover of the plant, probably in some stages. That's still to be worked out in detail. But then the department will go into cleanup preparatory to a D&D to decommissioning, and then the issue, which is not dissimilar to that in Piketon, is what can we do with those communities to help provide a new industrial activity that might provide an additional future at those sites. And for Paducah, it's well known, the department did ask for expressions of interest in terms of what might be done with the site, and that's something we'll have to evaluate this year.
Mr. Secretary, what is your opinion about the efficacy of the technology at the American Centrifuge Project?
Well, that's something that we will need to judge. The intent is that the demonstration of the cascade will, should, assuming funding is there, should end at the end of this year. That's the schedule. And then we have to see whether that looks to be a promising commercial technology, and then will come some decisions to be made. What is the case, of course, I think, as you know, is there is a sensitivity that currently we have no American origin uranium enrichment technology, and consequently, if and when we need enriched uranium for military purposes, we will not have the option. In fact, if I may comment, maybe a last comment going back to the uranium market, again, we have this report, which is, I think, coming along and will be available pretty soon. clearly, I understand completely the issue of balancing the various equities, uranium producers on the one hand, national security requirements on the other. So, for example, if you take Paducah, then a year ago or over a year ago, of course, there was uranium used at Paducah for an extra year of operation. That was for a well-defined national security purpose to make a tritium reserve for our weapons, whereas the recent proposal for an extension was declined because there was no national security purpose.
Oh, thank you, Dr. Moniz. And there is considerable interest on this committee on both sides of the aisle on small modular nuclear reactor technology and whether that has promise. I hope that our Subcommittee on Energy will have an opportunity to visit with you informally about your understanding of the status of that technology and the viability of that technology going forward. Mm-hmm. And we would invite you into those discussions at your convenience.
Great.
I want to thank you so much for your valuable testimony, and I want to thank the members for their questions. The members of the committee may have additional questions for you, and we'll ask you to respond to those in writing. The record will remain open for 2 weeks for additional comments and written questions for members. I would like now to offer Ranking Member Johnson, who has been so patient, her opportunity for closing remarks. Do you wish to comment?
Well, thank you. I just want to thank the Secretary again for coming and look forward to working with you, and thanks to you.
Thank you.
I thank the Ranking Member. I want to particularly thank you, Secretary Moniz, for joining us today. As you heard from numerous members of this committee, we have high hopes for a very positive working relationship with you going forward, and we look forward to that with a very robust scientific future for our country. And with that,
I do as well, even if we have little arguments sometimes. But I would look forward to a discussion, really.
And the operative word is little, because regardless of whether one believes in the role of mankind in increasing the effects of climate change, I think there's general agreement that the climates are changing. The amazing geology of my own state of Wyoming bears witness to climate change over eons of time. And if it's been exacerbated by mankind or not, we all agree on this committee that the importance of giving to our children and grandchildren the best world that we can is in everyone's best interest. So with that, the witness is excused and this hearing is adjourned.
Thank you.